Hello guys, this is the first tutorial for SOAP, the Scriptable Object Architecture. In this tutorial, we are going to use scriptable variables to detect inputs and move the player, and we are also going to make a basic health system with a dynamic health bar that updates when we take damage or heal the player. To save some time, I have already created a project and set up the main scene. As you can see in the project folder, I only have the obvious SOAP package, one scene, no script, and I already imported TextMeshPro. As for the scene itself, we only have the main camera, the light, the floor, and the player. Right now, the player only consists of a capsule collider, a mesh renderer, and a trail renderer that will give more feedback when we move the player. Alright, we are ready to implement the player movement. To do this, we will need to create two scripts. The first one, PlayerInputs, and then the second one, PlayerMovement. Let's double-click on the PlayerInput to open the code editor. In order to store the PlayerInputs, we are going to use a vector tree variable, which is a scriptable variable that stores a vector tree. So first, we need to go ahead and create a reference to a vector tree variable. Make sure you are using the namespace obviousSOAP to be able to use all the functionality of SOAP. Now in update, we are simply going to set the value of this variable. I am simply going to use input.getAccessHorizontal for the x coordinate and input.getAccessVertical for the z coordinate value. Great! Now that we are writing to this variable, we need to read it from our player movement class. We are going to copy this line and paste it into our player movement script. In order to move, we need both a direction and a speed. We already have the direction from the inputs vector tree variable, so let's go ahead and make a speed variable. Now, in update, we are going to move the player by doing transform.position plus equal the direction, in our case inputs.value, then the speed, and all that multiplied by time.deltaTime. Now let's go back to the inspector. Let's attach our new classes to our player. So add component player inputs and add component player movement. We can see that our two classes expect a vector tree variable, so let's create one. To do this, I am first going to stay organized and create a folder called SOAP and a subfolder called variables. Now we can go to create, SOAP, scriptable variables, and vector tree. Let's also rename it to vector tree underscore inputs. I like prefixing the type of the variable to the name so I can remember them easily, but you don't need to do that. Now we can drag this variable into our classes. Then we can hit play, and voila, the player moves. What is interesting about this method is that player inputs and player movement don't know about each other. They are independent, and that means that one class can exist and be used without the other. If you have made game before, you must have faced a situation where one class had a reference to another one in order to work. And if you wanted to reuse that class somewhere else, in the same game or in another game, you had to drag the other class as well. SOAP is all about solving this problem, which we call dependency, or spaghetti code, by adding a neutral middleman in between classes that will break that connection. This will make your code cleaner and reusable. We are now ready to implement a basic health system. This health system will rely entirely on a scriptable variable of type float. To create it, we go to create, SOAP, scriptable variable, and float. Let's also rename it to float underscore player health. Let's also create a new script and call it PlayerHealth. Now let's go ahead and open this class in the code editor. First, let's delete update and remove the comments above start. Now, let's create a reference to our float variable so we will be able to reference it in the inspector. Let's call it currentHealth. The first thing I want to show you is how we can trigger code when the value of this variable changes. We could of course monitor the value of the variable in update, but that would be inefficient and not really clean. Instead, we are going to rely on the onValueChanged event action of scriptable variables. To add a callback to this action, we can just type currentHealth.onValueChanged, then plus equal, and let's call it onHealthChanged. onHealthChanged is a new method that will be called every time the value of this variable changes. We can create it ourselves or use the code editor to do it for us. Let's not forget to unsubscribe from our onValueChanged event in the onDestroyUnity callback. To do this, we simply copy-paste the line and replace the plus with a minus. As you can see, this method has a parameter, which is the new value, so let's actually call it new value. This is useful for us because we can then compare the new value to the previous value to know if we got damaged or healed. Let's do this actually and compute the difference. So let's type new value minus currentHealth.previousValue. PreviousValue is a property available in all scriptable variables. Now, if the difference is below zero, that means we were damaged, and let's print damage to the console. Otherwise, that means we were healed, and let's print healed. Awesome, let's go back to the editor. Let's add our player health script to our player. Let's drag our player health variable into our script. There. Let's try this in play mode. To modify the value of the scriptable variable at runtime, you can select it in the project and modify it in the inspector, just like this. Or what I usually do, I select the object that has a reference to the variable, in this case the player, and then from the class PlayerHealth, I can expand the variable thanks to a custom inspector and change its value from here. Now remember, we printed some logs to know if we were being damaged or healed. Let's select the console and clear it. Now let's increase the value of the variable, and as you can see, we can see healed is printed to the console. Now if we decrease the value, yep, we are seeing damage. So everything is working so far as intended. We can also debug the value by enabling debug logs option on the variable itself. Now when the variable changes, a message is displayed in the console as well. Now this is great to debug in the inspector, but what if we want to add debug from our game so we can test in builds? To be able to test quickly from the game, let's make two buttons, one for healing and one for damaging the player. Let's first create a UI canvas, then a button, and let's make it bigger and move it to the bottom right corner. Because this is the healing button, let's make it green and change its text to something like heal. What we want is to increase the player health when this button is clicked. Because scriptable variables are assets, you can directly drag your variable into a Unity event and call a public method. In our case, we want to call add, and let's put something like 30. For damaging, it's very easy. We duplicate this button by pressing Ctrl D, then move it to the side, change its color to red, and change its text to something like damage. Finally, where we call add, we put a minus in front of 30 because we want to decrease the health. That's it. Now, when we play the game and click on the button damage, we can see that it logs damage in the console, and when we click on heal, it heals the player. Let's start making the health bar now. Let's create a new panel and name it Health Bar UI. Now let's create a new TextMeshPro. This will display the value of our health. Let's enable auto size, then go to add component, soap, bindings, BindTextMeshPro. Bindings are small scripts that are included with soap that perform simple and useful tasks. This one will display the value of our variable and update it when it changes. It also has some cool options. Let's try it out. In our case, the variable type is float. Then let's drag our player health variable. For the prefix, let's add health. We don't need a suffix, and for the decimal, we actually just want to display the number without any decimals, so let's put 0. Now when we hit play, and when we click on damage, we can see that the text is updating. Great. However, I don't really like that it displays negative number. To fix that, we can go to our binding component and enable isClamped, then set the min value to 0. This will make sure that even if the variable value goes below 0, it will not show it on the text. Let's try again now. And yes, the text is clamped at 0. Note that here, we are only clamping the text. If we want to clamp the variable value itself, we need to select the variable, enable isClamped, and set the minimum value to 0. Now, as you can see, we cannot set the value of the variable below 0 anymore. Now that we show the value of the health, let's do the actual health bar. Let's create a new panel and call it health bar, and let's give it a size that we like. Then let's create a new image as a child and let's make it fill its parent. For this image, we can set the sprite to health bar sprite, and then we can duplicate it. Let's change its color to green, set the image type to filled, and the fill method to horizontal. Now, when we change the value between 0 and 1, it will fill the image accordingly. Nice. We now need to bind it to our health. Of course, there is a binding script for that. It's called BindFillingImage. Let's attach it by clicking on Add Component and type BindFillingImage and then enter. As we can see, it requires one float variable and one float reference for the max value. For the float variable, let's use our player health. The float reference is a class in SOAP that enables you to choose between a scriptable variable and a local variable. In this case, let's choose local and put 100 for now. Let's play, heal a little bit, and as you can see, our health is now reflected in the image. Now, this is not ideal. We don't want to hardcode 100 in our binding component. Let's create a new float variable. And let's call it float player max health. Let's set its initial value to 100. This means that when the game starts, the variable value is going to be reset to 100. Now, let's go back to our binding script. Choose to use the float variable instead of the local variable, and reference our newly created max health. Now let's hit play, and yeah, everything still works the same. We forgot something though. Our current health is never set to our max health when the game starts, but that's an easy fix. Let's go back to the player health script and open it up in the editor. We just need to add a reference to another float variable, and let's call it max health. Then in start, let's set the value of the current health to the max health. Let's go back in the inspector and drag our max health in that reference. Now when we play the game, we can see that it works. To test it further, let's change the max health initial value to something like 1000 and play the game again. As you can see, our game adapts automatically to this. By having this setup, it will be very easy later to add abilities that increase our max health. In our game, we know that our player health is used by a few scripts: the health UI, the health bar image, and our player health script. Once your game becomes bigger, it might not be easy to remember all of this. Let's hit play and select our player health variable in the project folder. During play mode, there is a custom inspector on each variable that will show you exactly which objects and which scripts are referencing your variable. You can click this button to highlight the object in the hierarchy, and you can also click on the select button to select it. This is pretty much it for this video. If something isn't clear, don't hesitate to rewatch the video or to ask questions on the Discord channel. The link will be in the description. In the next video, we will showcase scriptable events and create our first enemy. If you like this tutorial and want to be notified when a new video is up, like this video and subscribe to the channel. Thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video.